day and a very warm welcome to everyone joining us in today's webinar on mechanical insufflation, exsufflation clinical application. At Philips, our brand purpose is to improve lives through meaningful innovations. It is possibly more relevant today than it has been over the course of our 129 years history. This has been a guiding principle in our response to the COVID-19 pandemic, helping instill confidence and clarity amongst the clinical community. As a global leader in healthcare technology, Philips has been delivering a range of clinical education programs to our clinicians and partners, tailoring to their needs and the roles that will increase and improve their skills and knowledge. Knowledge sharing is a key way for all of us to learn and develop, especially when we are dealing with the unknown. As the pandemic escalated, we deepened our commitment to these ideas, understanding that we have a triple duty of care to our people, to our customers, and to our businesses. The Philips Sleep and Respiratory Care Clinical Marketing Team has since hosted 4 webinars on NIV management for severe COVID-19 patients. Through these webinars, we receive feedbacks from clinicians that mechanical insufflation, exsufflation is one of the topics that they would like to be included for the future. In this webinar, we have the honor of inviting our esteemed speaker, Associate Professor Amanda Piper from Australia, to share her insights on MRE principles, clinical application, and benefits. We also have with us today Dr. Chan Yao from Singapore, Professor Chun Pan from China, Dr. Anita from Indonesia, and Associate Professor Nabrika from Thailand to share their MRE COVID-19 experience. We are confident that the experience sharing from our panel of experts would greatly benefit the healthcare community that has gathered here at this webinar. This will in turn benefit patients that we all ultimately serve. Thank you and enjoy the webinar.
Good evening. My name's Amanda Piper, and I'm a physiotherapist and manager of the respiratory support services at Royal Prince Alfred Hospital in Sydney. And I have the honour tonight to be helping to host this particular seminar. Before I begin my presentation, I'd like to just send out a poll regarding your current MIE practice. Please tick all the boxes that apply to you and then hit the submit button. Okay, so here are the results. It does seem that the majority of individuals, in fact, everyone who's on this webinar tonight, does use it in conjunction with non-invasive ventilation, and that seems to be primarily the main use of MIE in clinical practice.
So what we're talking about today is mechanical insufflation. And what I'd like to cover is talking a little bit briefly about cough and measuring its effectiveness, some of the studies and data we have that support the use of this technique in patients with excessive secretions, and what are we expecting with our outcomes, and some of the practical aspects of setting up therapy. When we're thinking about cough, there are 3 phases to it. The inspiratory phase, which is about inhaling to lung volumes, which are about 60 to 80% of total lung capacity. Then there's the compressive phase, which is about laryngeal muscle coordination, trying to achieve glottic closure and then very rapid opening. And at the same time, you've got the expulsive phase, where the glottis opens suddenly and you've got the expiratory muscles trying to contract to increase those expiratory flow rates. When it comes to patients with neuromuscular weakness, they can have problems in any one or all of these aspects of the cough phase. And we use a measurement, the peak cough flow, to determine how effective cough is. And that's the simplest bedside test that we can do. All we need is a face mask and an asthma peak cough flow meter, asking the patient to cough into the mask when it's on their face, and they should be able to generate pressures of over 360 litres per minute for an effective cough. we start thinking about cough augmentation techniques once the patients cannot generate a peak cough flow greater than 270 litres per minute. There are various cough augmentation techniques that we can use to aid cough effectiveness. These can either be manual techniques, such as the bag and mask approach. We can use manually assisted cough to help the expulsive phase, or we can use mechanical insufflation with the patient's own ventilators, with the idea of maximally insufflating the lungs and then increasing the expiratory flow rates. Mechanical cough assist devices allow us to achieve both of these goals in the same therapy. So what we're trying to do with mechanical cough assists or mechanical insufflation, exsufflation techniques is to simulate a normal cough. We do this, the machine applies a positive pressure to inflate the lungs, that's the insufflation, with a rapid shift to negative pressure or exsufflation. And this idea is to create an increase in the expiratory flow rates to help remove secretions from the central airways. So this is not a technique to move things from the periphery, it's about patients with a poor weak cough where they're unable to clear the secretions from the central airways, and this is where we would introduce this technique. We talk about using the technique when the peak cough flow is somewhere between 160 and 270 litres per minute, and this really comes from a number of studies showing that if you have a peak cough flow less than 160 litres per minute, then people with neuromuscular disorders are likely not to be able to either manage or do well following a severe chest infection. And the first study was that of John Bark, showing that if an individual who with a neuromuscular disorder was intubated, if they could generate more than 160 litres per minute, this was predictive of a successful extubation or decannulation from a tracheostomy. Other studies have shown that if an individual can create more than 270 litres per minute in their peak cough flow, they're unlikely to develop acute respiratory distress during a respiratory tract infection. And in ALS patients, peak cough flow less than about 250 was pretty good in predicting an ineffective cough when the patient developed an acute respiratory tract infection. So who's likely to benefit from MIE? Well, they're going to be patients mostly who have neuromuscular disorders where they have an ineffective cough. And we can use this on as a maintenance therapy at home or while they've got a respiratory tract infection or during acute respiratory failure. And certainly there are studies, for instance, by Louise Rose, showing more and more the use of mechanical cough assist devices in intensive cares for patients who, for instance, might experience prolonged ICU admissions, who develop respiratory muscle weak and fatigue, and also being used in selected patients who are intubated or post-extubation patients who are at high risk of developing secretion retention and therefore the need to be re-intubated. I think we have to be very cautious in using it in patients who have significant lung disease, whether that's COPD or bronchiectasis, because these individuals can often have floppy airways and the negative pressure that's created by the mechanical cough assist device can make that airway collapse much worse. We also, during insufflation, can run the risk of barotrauma. In this interesting, very recent study by Ren and colleagues, you can see here on the left-hand side the peak cough flow that can be generated in healthy individuals, those with COPD and in neuromuscular patients. And you can see compared to other cough augmentation techniques, including in the green, mechanical insufflation, exsufflation or cough assist, that many of the cough augmentation techniques are not as effective as just getting the patient with COPD to cough themselves. In contrast, in patients with neuromuscular disorders, the most effective way of increasing that peak expiratory flow rate is to be using the cough assist device. So therefore, if we're thinking about using mechanical insufflation, exsufflation or cough assist in patients with lung disease, we have to really very carefully think, is this really indicated in this particular patient? What settings are we using? And are we achieving the benefits we think that we're achieving? So let's now turn and look at some of the evidence around the benefits and outcomes of mechanical cough assist in patients. And if we simply look at the literature and look at the systematic reviews and meta-analyses, there's very limited evidence that MIE is efficacious beyond the fact that we know it increases peak cough flow and inspiratory capacity. And that's largely because of the lack of good quality randomized controlled trials in the area. Most of the studies that have been used in these reviews are observational or case series. And what we don't have is any data looking at survival. However, we do know clinically there's a lot of data just showing how effective cough assist devices can be in day-to-day practice in patients who've got neuromuscular weakness, who have problems clearing those secretions because of a weak cough. And because of that, despite that lack of high quality evidence, cough assist techniques are recommended by a whole range of international guidelines looking at the management of neuromuscular disease. We have studies showing physiologically that cough assist devices, as you would hope, increase peak cough flow, but also seem to, in some individuals, able to either improve or at least stabilize that reduction in vital capacity that can occur in the longer term. It tends to improve chest wall asymmetry or movement in some studies, and also showing that it can improve in intubated patients, improved respiratory mechanics, at least in the short time, which might lead to a reduction in that feeling of shortness of breath short term. In a study by Chatwin, for instance, comparing a whole range of different cough assist techniques, unassisted cough compared to physio-assisted or manually assisted cough compared to using insufflation from the patient's mechanical ventilator, you can see that the mechanical insufflation-exsufflation technique produces the best peak cough flows, not only in adults, but also in children. If we look at some of the clinical studies in the acute settings, using cough assist devices reduce the treatment time. If we look at in the intensive care type areas, showing that we might, even in intubated patients, using these types of devices, increasing the amount of secretions that are removed compared to just general chest physiotherapy. And again, some evidence showing that you might get better short-term improvements in lung compliance compared to other techniques. If we think about the home setting, most of the studies have just been pre-post studies. In this particular study from Moran from Queensland, showing that there was a reduction in hospitalisation days, both at 6 and 12 months, when they looked at patients before and after the introduction of mechanical cough assist. Similarly, this more recent study in children with neuromuscular disorders showing that the incidence of respiratory tract infection related hospital admissions, there was a significant reduction in the median number comparing pre-introduction of MIE to once MIE was being used in the home. And the admission days, median admission days, also reduced pre, it was just over 30 days, to after the introduction of MIE, it was down to less than 3 days. In another Australian study from WA, they surveyed 37 patients using MIE at home and were able to link their surveys to their health record and found that there were 2 to 3 times higher hospitalizations and length of stay pre-MIE compared to post-MIE. And because of the numbers, this wasn't significant. But what was significant was the number of presentations to the emergency department after the introduction of the cough assist device. So let's turn now just to some of the practical aspects of introducing mechanical cough assist. When we're thinking about setting up therapy, what we have to consider is adjusting both the inhalation pressures and the exhalation pressures, as well as the time, to try to achieve an inhalation volume and a peak cough flow that's going to be effective for that patient. And generally speaking, from many years ago, we know that we need sufficiently high pressures to be effective. And most of the time, that's somewhere in the range of between 35 to maybe 40 or 45 centimetres, depending on the patient and their underlying characteristics. The other aspect and parameter we have to adjust is the inhalation flow that can also affect these values. So I tend to deal with adult patients, and so I'm just going to go through my particular approach, which is just based on experience and what I've seen in the literature, and it is just simply one approach. We would normally start in the manual mode with a low flow, because a lot of our patients actually are patients with ALS, so we would start with a low flow, starting with an inspiratory pressure of about 15 centimetres, or if they're already on non-invasive ventilation, about 5 centimetres higher than whatever their IPAP pressure that they're currently using. Looking at the insufflation time, we set that to try and maximise the chest rise when we're placing that pressure on the patient. And usually in adults, it's somewhere between 1.5 to 3 seconds. I know from the literature, they talk more about 0.5 to 1.5 in children, depending on their age. And then we try to increase that inspiratory pressure to the maximum that the patient tolerates. We then go about adding the exhalation, and again, starting at minus 10 or minus 20, depending on the patient's tolerance and their underlying diagnosis. And we continue to make that pressure more negative to try to increase the peak cough flow or improve the cough sound the patient is making. And during that time, we're adjusting the expiratory times as well. If we're still not achieving a good peak cough flow, then what we would be doing is asking the patient to cough or huff during that exhalation, and also certainly in patients who have a lot of respiratory muscle weakness, adding manual compression. Ideally, if the patient can manage it, we would introduce cough track so the patient starts the breath off themselves, and wherever possible, we would use the auto mode. Generally, we are using a full face mask, although for some patients, particularly for independence, they will prefer a mouthpiece. It can be used via a tracheostomy or an endotracheal tube, but just remembering in these circumstances, you will need to increase the pressures more than you would if you were just using the same therapy if the patient was using a mask. And particularly the smaller the tube, the more resistance to that pressure is going to occur. So you may need to put your pressures higher. It is useful to have a look at the inhalation pressures that you're getting from the machine, but just remembering if you've got a large leak from around the mask, it'll reduce the effectiveness of those pressures, even though the inhalation volumes might appear quite high. And it is important that you're not just pushing the mask very hard on the patient's face, but rather, as shown up here, trying to mould the mask to the patient's face. Now, there are considerable variation in the settings used when you look in the literature, and we don't have a good way of working out exactly how to optimise settings in general. We do it on an individual basis. Lots of studies have set the inhalation and exhalation pressure to the same value, for instance, 30 centimetres in and out, or 40 centimetres. In a very recent survey of practice amongst European paediatric expert centres, Hov and colleagues showed that, in fact, a lot of people, about 50%, were using asymmetric pressure settings, with the expiratory pressure being higher than the inspiratory pressure in 116 out of the cases where asymmetric pressures were being used. The other thing they showed is that there was a general increase in both inhalation and exhalation pressures as the child aged. Similarly, the inspiratory and expiratory time settings were also asymmetric in about 65% of cases. Most of the time, the inspiratory time was longer than the expiratory time. And again, there was a little less, but still changes in those settings as the patient aged. And this sort of fits in with an infant lung model by Striegel almost a decade ago, showing that if you have a lower inspiratory compared to an expiratory pressure, so a bigger differential between inspiration and expiration, that did create higher peak expiratory flow rates in a lung model. Similarly, in adults, a recent paper by LaMolda showing that if you individually set the inspiratory and expiratory pressures as I described, you can produce higher peak cough flows in about 62% of patients compared to just using a straight, in this case, they were just using 40 centimetres, both inhalation and exhalation. The other thing to consider is your inhalation flow rates. What you want to do is create a peak expiratory flow that's of high enough velocity to shear the secretions off the airways and move them forward to the back of the throat where the patient can be spat out or suctioned out. And in animal and lung models, what we usually talk about is we want a peak expiratory flow that's about 10% higher than the inspiratory flow rate. So therefore, it probably makes sense, and a recent lung model shows that a slower insufflation can be more effective. And similarly, in the same model, they had mucus in the model, and there was greater displacement of the mucus up the trachea and out when there was a larger expiratory flow bias. So again, when the expiratory pressures were greater than the inspiratory pressures. A particular case or indication where MIE can be very tricky to apply is that in patients with ALS, particularly those with bulbar dysfunction. And it was nearly two decades ago that Sancho and colleagues showed that you can get up airway collapse during exhalation at these at pressures of negative 40 centimetres. And more recently, Tina Anderson and her group showed that using video laryngoscopy, not only did you get vocal cord adduction during exhalation, but you also got some adduction during insufflation in patients not only with bulbar dysfunction, but those without as well. And you also had the added problem of obstruction of airflow by backward movement of the tongue base during insufflation in both bulbar and non-bulbar ALS patients, rendering the therapy less effective. And certainly what they showed in subsequent studies was that as the disease progresses, there is a tendency for people to increase the insufflation pressure, and that can actually be counterproductive because it can make some of these problems even worse. And one of the nice things they've come up with some, you know, some ideas that we can use to try to improve the effectiveness of therapy in this particular population. So using a lower inhalation pressure and flow, as well as a longer TI, can give better laryngeal stability and also less likely to trigger some of the laryngeal reflexes that you might see in patients with bulbar dysfunction. Also, if you can get the patient to actively inspire, so using something like cough track can also improve that coordination between the diaphragm contraction and some of the upper airway abductor muscles. And very recently, they showed that in some of these patients, just using one cough cycle, an insufflation and exhalation and pausing, might in fact be much better than doing a whole series of cough cycles at one time in this particular population. We would not use MIE for any of the reasons and you sort of listed here, exactly the same reasons why you don't use positive pressure therapy in any patient. And thinking about the possible complications, in particular pneumothoraces, and just warning the patients about symptoms and signs that they might experience should a pneumothorax occur. I think the other considerations which are important are the patient and carer training. We do have to put time into that upfront and periodically review them. We also need to think about monitoring and reviewing effectiveness, particularly in patients with progressive disorders, and thinking about how adherent are they to therapy. I think it's important to realise that the majority of patients with neuromuscular disorders don't have daily secretions. And in fact, maybe only 50% of them are going to be using their devices daily. But yet, it's really important that they do use them regularly and their carers so that they've got the skills. So when they do get a respiratory tract infection, they are good at using therapy. And one of the things now we've got these programs where we can set up different programs. We'll use some LVR, getting the patients to do some manual insufflation as part of their daily routine with some coughs at the end, hoping to do things like maintain or improve their lung and chest wall compliance by doing regular daily manual insufflation as well as some cough therapy as well. The other thing that these devices we can set up are oscillations, particularly during chest infections where the secretions become thick and sticky, oscillations can be quite useful. There was some concern that in patients with ALS with very hyperreflexive reflexes that these oscillations may impact on the effectiveness of cough, but Sancho showed that that didn't seem to be the case. And in fact, a recent study by Anderson showed that oscillations at 10 hertz during the insufflation phase actually seemed to stabilize the upper airway or the larynx in patients with ALS, so something to consider. So just to finish off, I think mechanical cough assist has quite an established role in the respiratory care of patients with ineffective cough. But it is important to remember it is just one of our techniques in our toolbox for airway clearance, and we use it when other techniques are not effective, where we can't get peak cough flows above that 160 litres per minute. There is certainly a wide variation in how therapy is set up and used, and we don't really know how to optimise settings in most patients, and that needs a lot more work. And we also need a lot more work and longer term studies looking at how adherent and effective therapy is over time, and certainly studies looking at quality of life and survival. Thank you very much, and we'll get now onto our panel. So what I would like to do now is introduce our panelists for this evening who are going to share their experiences with their use of mechanical cough assist. We have Dr. Chan Yao from Singapore with us tonight. We also have Professor Chun Pang from Southeast University in China, Associate Professor Nablika from Bangkok in Thailand, and also Dr. Anita from Jakarta in Indonesia. So what I'd like to do is invite Dr. Anita to present and share her experience of MIE in intubated patients.
Hello, good evening, everyone. I'm Anita from Persahabatan Hospital in Jakarta. I would like to share my experience using mechanical insufflation, exufflation in patient in ICU setting. Patient which was intubated for the infection. This is the patient, 67-year-old male, was intubated in ICU with diagnosis of stroke. He had several recurrent stroke. And the last time he was admitted in a hospital, he had pneumonia and progressively has sepsis, then was transferred to ICU and was intubated. At the time I examined the patient, the Richmond Agitation Sedation score was O without any neurological blocking agents at that time. And he had communication problem. Actually, it was several months before he was admitted in hospital. And he has impaired coughing. The coughing ability was very declined. So the problem of this patient, he had a thick, very thick phlegm and was not effectively expelled from the airway. Measurement with the mechanical insufflation exufflation device, we had the peak flow value was 86 liter per minute. And in this condition, the patient was failed winning in several efforts to try. At the last time, he was in TPS, but was not success to extubate it. So the patient was planned to undergo tracheostomy. It was in a consultation with ENT doctors when I was visited the patient in ICU. The patient then was applied with mechanical insufflation exufflation machine to enhance mucus clearance. And also we would like to improve the maximum insufflation capacity because regarding the condition, latest condition of the patient, then the value of peak flow, the patient obviously had a limited insufflation capacity of diaphragm. So he was applied with the mechanical insufflation exufflation machine. And the peak flow value after the mechanical insufflation with this machine was increased very significant, from 86 to 189 liters per minute. And at the time, the mucus was very much expelled from the airway. It's about 300 milliliters at the time. We did it twice a day. It's very good result. The next day, the patient was successfully extubated without undergoing tracheostomy. From the experience, actually, it's not the only patient. We apply with mechanical insufflation in terms to increase the maximum insufflation capacity. But from this patient, the lesson learned we got that the mechanical insufflation, extubation's benefit, it's been very beneficial for intubated patient, not only to enhance the mucus clearance, but in this case, it is very well increased lung compliance by improving maximum insufflation capacity, especially for diaphragm, which we well know that very much affected during mechanical ventilation application, especially for those patients with prolonged mechanical ventilation. The lesson learned from this case that we need to consider to improve maximum insufflation capacity before we decide for patient undergo tracheostomy, because it is very well improving the diaphragm movement, even though it's assistive device, but it is very well improving insufflation capacity for those patients that diaphragm has dysfunction from the prolonged mechanical ventilation. So it is my experience from intubated patient in ICU. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Anita. I'd like to now invite Dr. Chan Yao to come and provide his experience and share them with us regarding MIE in the home setting.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Chan Yao, and I'm from Tan Tock Seng Hospital, Singapore. I do not have any financial disclosures for this webinar. And these four pictures just show our hospital at the bottom left corner, a map of Singapore. We are a very small island. And on the top right, you see the portrait of the founder of our hospital, Mr. Tan Tock Seng. So in 2008, we had a patient with mid-cervical injury who was unable to wean off the ventilator. And that started our hospital on a journey to start a home ventilation service. So you see the gentleman, Mr. Au, in the top left picture. Over the last 10 years, we have looked after more than 270 patients at home with a variety of diagnoses, but largely neuromuscular weakness, cervical cord injuries. And the use of the cough assist machine, as well as other cough modalities, has helped to keep our patients fairly healthy. So we have been able to avoid serious pneumonia, and we now have to battle with other issues, for example, like urinary tract infections, soft tissue infections. And lately, very much focused upon improving quality of life through psychological and other rehabilitative measures. The use of cough assist has also allowed us to decannulate or to extubate patients with neuromuscular weakness. So this gentleman was admitted to our ICU with a severe pneumonia. He's got a background of Becker's dystrophy. And after several weeks in the ICU, we extubated him to non-invasive ventilation. And I'm happy to announce that actually currently he only needs to use NIV when he has got respiratory exacerbations, but he uses a cough assist machine regularly to maintain his lung and chest wall compliance. We did an audit of our cases, and this has been published in the Journal of Thoracic Diseases. And within our case series, we can see that actually for the patients who use home mechanical ventilation, the survival is significantly improved compared to those who refuse home mechanical ventilation, so the ones with dotted line. However, I must clarify that whilst the data was for home mechanical ventilation, as far as possible, we have been using cough assist machine for our patients with ALS, with muscle weakness, in accordance with guidelines such as the 2010 Canadian Thoracic Society, as well as the 2017 German Pneumology Society guidelines. So according to the Canadian Thoracic Society guidelines, once the peak cough flow is less than 160 with various maneuvers like lung volume recruitment or manually assisted cough, they would benefit from a trial of cough assist. So this would be what we practice for patients who are on natural airways. But for patients who have been intubated in the ICU and subsequently tracheostomized, the cough assist is really a wonderful device that keeps them healthy and out of hospital after that. So I'm showing you the German 2017 guidelines where they highlight that in patients with lack of cough ability due to muscle weakness from neuromuscular diseases, spinal cord paralysis, or ICU acquired weakness, the use of assisted coughing is highly recommended. What is a cough assist machine? Essentially, it is a ventilator combined with a vacuum cleaner. So it blows air into the patient's airways and then it creates a negative pressure to suck the secretions out. You would have heard Dr. Amanda's description of the process, how to titrate and adjust settings. I'd just like to show you how effective it is. So this is a video showing a patient with tracheostomy, and you can see the copious purulent secretions that remove just using the cough assist. In this case, he is using a cuffless tracheostomy tube. So we have to clear the secretions both from the tracheostomy flex connector as well as the mouth. But if the patient is using a cuff tube, then all the secretions will go into the trach connector. And you can see when we wash the trach connector, that very fibrinous mucoid mucus plugs are removed. So in this case, it's just lightly yellow colored. But if someone has a clear infection, they would have dark green secretions or even lightly bloodstained secretions. At home, we struggle with using hospital standards of infection control. So our patients are taught to use either distilled water or cool boiled water for cost savings. Dr. Amanda would have alluded to the caution that needs to be applied in patients with bulbar ALS. They get a spastic closure of the vocal cords during insufflation, and they have a passive collapse of the pharyngeal structures and the back of the tongue during exsufflation. So we follow the advice given by Tina Anderson's group very closely to use a cough track if possible, to use low insufflation pressures, longer insufflation time, and always adjusting the settings to optimize the air entry upon insufflation and effectiveness and comfort of cough during exsufflation. We have produced many videos for the benefit of patients and their families. You can go onto YouTube, look up TTSH HVRSS, and amongst the 14 videos, some are on emergency maneuvers, some on respiratory distress or diagnosis or recognition. But we have one particular video for the use of the cough assist machine. Please feel free to visit and to share widely. So you can find these videos as in the right-hand view of this slide. We also have a Facebook page. It's a combination of patient and family education as well as advocacy for people with neuromuscular breathing weakness. So also please come and visit our Facebook page and feel free to share the articles if you find them helpful for you. Thank you.
I'd like to now invite Associate Professor Nuplika if she could present her experiences with MIE in the post-extubated patients.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Nuplika Kongkornrom from King Chulalongkorn Memorial Hospital, Bangkok, Thailand. It's great honor to share my research about mechanical insufflation exsufflation or MIE in post-extubated patients. MIE is widely used in the neuromuscular weakness disease, but there are still limited data in the patients, critically ill patients. The best conduct a study to compare cough efficacy between implementations of the MIE with volume targets and the pressure targets in post-extubated patients. The primary outcomes was the amount of secretions after MIE implementations, and the secondary outcomes was the maximal exit pressure changes and adverse events. So the research design is a prospective randomized crossover design. We enrolled the patients who extubated, just recently extubated, and have the history of the mechanical ventilations for more than 24 hours. And we randomly assigned into two groups. The first group that we provide the MIE with the volume target, and the second group we provide MIE with the pressure target. The volume target means we titrate the inspiratory pressure until the patients achieve the predicted vital capacity and the cupric force of 360 liters per minute. And for the pressure target, we use the fixed inspiratory pressure and expiratory pressures, 40 and minus 40 centimeters water. Total of 25 patients were enrolled. The mean pressure were 40. Noticeably, the patients who use the volume target, the cupric force just only 200 liters per minute, which not achieve the target because the patients could not tolerate the pressure that can make them to achieve the vital capacity and cupric flow. For the primary outcome, the sputum volume was not statistically significant and there were no any adverse events. Parameters of the hemodynamics and respiratory and oxygenation were similar between two groups, but we observed that regardless of the mode or the volume target or the pressure target used, maximum expiratory pressure tend to be increased after implement of the MIE. To conclude of the first study, in the post-extubated patients, cuff efficacy after implementation was not different between volume target and pressure target. MIE was safe and tend to improve cuff strength after extubation. So we conduct another study to evaluate the re-intubation rate after provide the MIE in post-extubation patients. And we select the pressure target because the patients will tolerate to this technique. We conduct the randomized controlled trials to determine the efficacy of the reductions of the re-intubation rate during 48 hours post-extubation period. The patients with the history of the mechanical ventilations for more than 48 hours were enrolled. And we all had a cup peak flow or PSV flow before intubation. We select the patients who have the impaired cup peak flow. The cup peak flow less than 270 liters per minute were enrolled. And we exclude the patients who have the contraindications of their MIE, such as the patients with the history of thoracoabdominal surgery, the patients who have the bullous lung disease, hemoptysis, or pneumothorax. The primary outcome of this study is the re-intubation rate during the 48-hour post-extubation period. And the secondary outcome is the oxygenation improvement, cup peak flows, and adverse event during 48 hours period. And after we enrolled, for the control group, the patients received the standard post-extubation care. And in the MIE group, we provide the MIE before the intubation and after 30 minutes after extubation and repeat the MIE twice a day for 2 days and observe the outcome. The re-intubation rate was not different between two groups. The MIE group, there are two patients in the MIE group re-intubated, but it's not related to the procedure. The reasons for re-intubated were volume overload and vocal cord edema. And we observed that the patients in the MIE group had a better cup peak flow after implementation and had a better PF ratio at 48 hours period. To conclude, the cup access procedures during the post-extubation period did not prevent re-intubation, but it might improve oxygenation and cup strength during the 48-hour post-extubated period without increase the adverse events. For these two studies, it demonstrates that MIE was safe in the post-extubation, but it needs further study to confirm the data of the re-intubation outcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. If I could invite Dr. Pan from China to present some of his experience with using MIE in COVID-19.
Thank you very much to invite me to make the presentation on the topic of the MIE in COVID-19 induced ARDS. Today, I just want to present a case report in Wuhan, China. The patient is a female and 58 years old, and the patient have the fever for 9 days and respiratory distress for 5 days. The SARS-CoV-2 is positive. The patient have the hypertension, and when the patient admitted, did not have the fever, the temperature is 36.8, and heart rate 92, respiratory 28, blood pressure is okay. And the SpO2 is a little lower. SpO2 is 93%, FiO2 is at the 53%. The ABG shows that the PF ratio is 122, it's moderate ARDS. For the when the patient getting to the ICU, and we give the patient a prone position and some treatment, but did not get better. The patient still have the fever, have a dry cough, and the chest distress. The P is that the patient have the high temperature, so 39°C, 122. For the heart rate, respiratory rate is 32, and blood pressure normal. And we give the patient the very higher inspiration oxygenation, but the SpO2 around 98%. The ROX index is 3.8. The ABG, we can find that it's getting worse than the first day. So for the patient, we intubated the patient, and this is the situation in Wuhan Jintan Hospital, China, and we intubated this patient at the bedside, and we said the tidal volume is 360 milliliters and 6 liters per kilogram, and respiratory rate is 20, and the PEEP is 10, and the FiO2 is 100, SpO2 is 96%. And we can also see that the patient X-ray is getting worse from the first day to the second day. Then we give the patient a prone position ventilation, and we want to improve the pulmonary homogeneity, and we found that after the prone position, the dead space and the shunt improve, and the PF ratio improve, and lung mechanics and improve. And we give the patient treat the 12 days, and we can see that at the 12 days, the X-ray is getting better than the day 5. So we prepare to wean the patient, but the patient, we give the long, very, very long time, the neuromuscular blockage and the sedatives and anesthetic medicines to control the pain and sedation. So when we weaning the neuromuscular blockage and the sedatives, and the patient cough is very poor. So we use the mirror to help the patient to cough. And the first thing you want to jaunage the secretion. And the second thing is we want to help the patient to cough and improve the diaphragm function. So this is our set before we extubate this patient. The inhale pressure is 35 centimeter water, and the inhale time is 2 seconds. Expirate high pressure is negative 35 centimeter water. Exhale time is 2 seconds, and the cough is 3 times, and number of cycle is 3, and we do it 3 times per day. And for this patient, is very, very lucky that after we the treatment, the patient, everything getting better, and day 14th, and we weaning the patient. Also, the patient, the cough is not getting better, but the expiratory peak flow, we monitor at the ventilator is improved from 80 liter per minute to 110 liter per minute, also a little poor. So after the extubation, we also use a mirror to help the patient do the cough therapy, continued for 3 days. It's also the first thing we want to join in the secretion. Second thing, we want to help the patient to the diaphragm. After the day 18th, we can see the patient, this is a CT scan, and we can see some fibrosis at the dorsal part of the lung. At the day 20th, we transfer the wards, and at the day 26th, the patient discharge. At the day 24th, we do the CT scan, we compare to the day 18th, it's a little poor, but we can also see some fibrosis at the dorsal part. But now the patient is getting better, can walk, can live by herself. Okay, thank you. This is our patient. And I think we, all of the doctors, we always try our best to serve our patients. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Pan. So what I want to do now is we'll just have a look and see if we have some questions. There is one question here asking about the use of oscillations, considering whether or not you might use it during insufflation or exsufflation. We will use the oscillations when patients have got thick secretions. I'll try both on inspiration and on expiration. I tend to generally do it more
for patients who haven't got ALS, we'll do it during the expiratory phase just to see if it helps to remove secretions a little more easily. I think one of the important things to remember when you're doing oscillations, depending on your amplitude, so we start off small and then increase it, but it will, depending on how big the amplitude, you are going to reduce and then increase the actual pressure in the airway. So just remembering, if you're thinking that you're applying 35 centimetres, you will, during that oscillation, it will be increased and also decreased. But I think the important thing is that a lot of people will worry that the oscillations might cause some patients to have bulbar dysfunction, to cause maybe some irritation of the upper airway and cause some glottic closure. But certainly the work that's been done by Sancho and colleagues, that doesn't seem to be the case.
And from my experience in the critical ill patient, the patient usually have the secretion at the peripheral areas, because we can suction it easily if the secretion is in the central part, but in the peripheral, we cannot suction the secretion clearly. So for me, I use oscillation in every case.
In every case. Okay, excellent. Now, we have another question here asking about, do the inspiratory and expiratory times, should they be the same length? I tend to do a longer, most patients, and this, it does have to be individually tailored, but my tendency is to start off with a longer inspiration and a shorter expiration, because it's very much about trying to increase the expiratory flow rates. So I like to make it nice and slow on inspiration and then as quickly as possible on expiration, to increase that peak cough flow. But there is some, you know, some variability amongst it. And if you look at the literature, you see there's a huge amount of variability. What about some of the other panelists?
From my experience, I always started with longer inhalation time, because back to the physiology of coughing mechanism, that coughing mechanism always started with inspiratory phase. So we need to improve the inspiratory capacity to improve the coughing ability of the patient. So I always started with longer inhalation time. Then to enhance the expelling of the flame, I changed to longer exhalation time.
Okay. And a comment from Dr. Chan, he also likes the exhalation phase to be slightly shorter. One of the participants wanted to know about what safety measures were being used with the MIE with the COVID-19 patients in terms of the risk of creating some sort of pneumothorax and that during the procedure in these COVID-19 patients.
In my experience, and we can connect a filter at the end of the endotracheal tubes. This is for the intubated patient. Also, it may be a little influence the flow of the peak, but it can give us some information of the patient and give us some pressure for our patient. This is first. Second, and for the patient with non-invasive ventilation or the patient have been weaning, and if we use the mirror to help a patient cough, the drainage secretion, and just as the professor said, should use the mask to help the patient.
I think we'll have to finish on that question, but Dr. Chan from Singapore also commented that they only use the patient's own cough assist machine, and it had to be in a negative pressure room for anybody who was suspected of having COVID for safety reasons. I think all that's left now for me to do is to thank you all for joining us tonight. I hope you take away from this some ideas and some ways in which mechanical cough assist is being used throughout the Asian region in all sorts of different areas and applications. And I'd also like to thank Philips for the opportunity for providing a platform where we can start to discuss the use of this very interesting and growing technique for the management of patients who have an ineffective cough and excessive secretions. Thank you very much.